To church. It's been, some of you are like, hey, I remember that guy. He used to be a pastor here, like, weeks ago, right? So, my name is Jason Domingo. I am soon to be Chaplain Jason Domingo at, in the United States Army, which is super exciting. Yes. So, it's great to be back. I was youth pastor here for 17 years, and obviously had wonderful time, and my wife and I and family are still attending. We'll be attending here until May. May is when I actually go to chaplain school down in Fort Jackson, South Carolina, and then I'll spend 12 weeks there. And then I just found out that we're going to be stationed for at least 3 years in Fort Campbell in Kentucky, which is about an hour north of Nashville. It's right on the border of Tennessee and Kentucky. So if you're driving through to Nashville or Florida, which are great places to visit or even live, drop by, give us a call. We'd love to catch up and see any of you that are passing through. So it's great. Well, we're in a series called "That's In There?" Verses that demand a response. So the whole idea of this series is if you've ever read the Bible and kind of been thrown off by like, oh, I didn't realize that was in there, or I forgot, or how did I miss that? This is a series for you. And just a reminder, you can always go back on YouTube and rewatch or watch any of the messages that you may have missed from this series, because there's been a lot of great and challenging talks talking about some tough stuff in the Bible. So I can't believe it's already been a month and a half. Living my Mr. Mom life, planning meals and cooking dinner and learning how to fold laundry and running instruments and lunches to school when kids forget them, which is, seems to be more often than not. And all that fun stuff. And Errol texts me out of the blue and says, hey, can you come back and preach? I said, sure. What do you want me to preach on? He said, I want you to preach on hell. Like, yeah. Just, you know, kind of wuss out and leave when the hard topics come up and just call the guy who used to be here to talk about hell. And so it's like, here I am, and, you know, enjoying my Mr. Mom time, and now I got to spend a week and a half or 2 weeks thinking about hell. Who wants to prepare for a sermon on hell? Because it's so depressing, right? It's like, do you want to really, like, sit down in your quiet time and just meditate on hell and read a bunch of scripture passages on hell? I thought maybe I'll just lighten the mood and share some hell puns, right, in my sermon. Like, what are they going to do, fire me? So here are my top 10 hell pun. No, I'm kidding. I'll save the hellish puns for another time. Yeah, that landed better than the other two services. A couple weeks ago, I was in San Antonio, and I was at an Army training with a bunch of reserve chaplains, and I had just found out that I was going to Fort Campbell, and I was specifically assigned to the 2506, which is a battalion that trains at the 101st Airborne Division in Kentucky. So the 2506 is like my unit. I get to be their chaplain, and I'm looking online, and I find out like it's the same unit that gets followed in the HBO miniseries Band of Brothers. Right? So I'm like, man, that's so cool. It's like Easy Company and all this, and they're featured in Saving Private Ryan. So they have this historic lineage of being a battalion that's been involved in some major missions in World War II and in Vietnam as well. So I find this out, and I'm doing all this research, 101st Airborne and my unit and their unit patch and such, And I'm leaving the hotel to go to where the training was at. And I get on the elevator. I'm on the fifth floor. And second floor, it stops. And on walks this guy, older gentleman. He's got a hat. And it's an Army hat. And it says 101st Airborne. And on the side of it, is a patch, and it's the patch from the 2506, the unit I'm going to. I'm like, that's so cool. Like, you know, God just gives you some of these like fun little moments where he's just, I don't know, just these coincidences, but it's really nice. So I end up talking to him, and I said, sir, I'm going to be serving as a chaplain for that same unit. Were you in that unit? He says, yes, I was, and I served in Vietnam. So we got off the elevator, and we're talking for about 10 minutes. He's telling me about just some of his time there, and so he's like, you know, that's like a pretty historic unit, right? He's like, you're going to be so proud that, you know, you got to serve with that unit. I said, oh, I'm so humbled to be going there and only hope I can live up to the historic lineage and high expectations of that unit, you know. But he's telling me about a battle that his unit was involved in at the end of the Vietnam War, because it was about 1970, 1971, and they were in a battle, and he says, there's a book you should check out. It's called Hell on a Hilltop. I thought, that's a great name for a book, right? Real thriller. But I thought, that's interesting. Errol just told me I'm going to be speaking about hell, and it just reminded me, like, how if you read any military history, you often come across that term, that war is hell and should be avoided at all costs because it's painful and it's bitter. And we often associate, when we think about hell or use it in kind of a metaphorical way, we associate it with things like the Holocaust or genocide or suffering, pain, some of the worst circumstances that people can experience on earth. And some of you have been there to agree. Maybe you weren't a part of a genocide or anything, but you've suffered through hellish situations in your own life, whether it was a health issue or someone in your family was suffering and you felt like you were going through hell. And yet even the suffering on earth, though it's related to hell, is not hell itself. Right? Which leads to the question, what the heck is hell, right? What is it? Because there's kind of all this mystery surrounding it sometimes. And if you've grown up in the church or you see it depicted in popular culture, like you may have a cartoonish sort of visual of it, of a place with flames and a little devil with a pitchfork. And there's been a lot of misconceptions over the years, even within the church world. One of the early church fathers, Origen, actually taught that hell was a place where wicked souls were purified so that they could find their way back to God. Unfortunately, that's not what you see in Scripture. A guy named Dante in the 1400s wrote an epic poem in Italian that was all about the journey to the afterlife, and he depicted hell as being under the earth, and that there's 9 levels of suffering that people see or pass through. And C.S. Lewis depicted hell as a gloomy place where being just fades away into non-entity, which is also not necessarily scriptural. The great theologians AC/DC said, hell ain't a bad place to be. It's where all my friends are, right? There's another pastor named Rob Bell, a prominent pastor several years ago, who said hell really isn't a physical place or a place where people are to spend eternity. It's really representative of the sufferings that people can experience here on earth. And that's not scriptural as well. And though it's common to use hell in a joking manner, there's really nothing funny about it when you really think about it and really dig down deep. And years ago, a pastor named Francis Chan wrote a book called Erasing Hell, What God Said About Eternity and the Things That We've Made Up. And he actually wrote it in response to that pastor, Rob Bell, who kind of dismissed hell as being figurative and said, no, hell was at the time of Jesus a commonly held Jewish belief that it was real and that it was a judgment, an eternal judgment, and was a real concern. And there's a few vague Old Testament references to hell that we could go into, but it would take a lot and would take a whole other class, but it uses the term Sheol, which is not hell, but you read in the Psalms, it's sometimes translated as the grave or like a place where we go when we die and await judgment. But the Jews in Jesus' day and Jesus himself believed in a real judgment, a real hell. In fact, Jesus said that when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, then he will sit on his glorious throne. Before him will be gathered all the nations, and he will separate people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. That there is going to be a day when those would be judged to receive eternity and eternal fellowship with God, or eternity in hell apart from God. And the truth is that if hell was only a figurative place, then Jesus could have easily dispelled that notion, right? He could have said, because he said, no, hell is not real, and here I am, Savior of the world, Son of God, here to save all of you, no matter who you are, what you do, no matter what you believe, I'm going to bring you all there. And yet that's not what he preached and taught. In summary, and Chan summarizes this in his book, he says, they believe that hell was a place of punishment after judgment, right? That hell is described in imagery of fire and darkness where people lament. That hell is a place of annihilation or never-ending punishment. And that's something that some Christians will differ on, is that you read some passages in Scripture and you can read that and take away that, well, perhaps hell is annihilation, that those who reject God will simply be annihilated out of existence and will not live. But then you read other passages and it seems to suggest that no, hell is actually a punishment. It's the wrath of God fully experienced to those who reject him and who want nothing to do with him. And Jesus, he speaks about it quite a bit. In fact, Pastor Brent reminded me last night that Jesus actually teaches and talks about hell more than he actually talks about heaven. It's this utter diminishment of all that is good. And though it's the absence of God and everything good, but as my friend Jason was reminding me last service, it's not just the absence of God. God is there. You just don't experience the goodness of God. Instead, you experience his wrath. And on earth, we experience glimpses of both heaven and hell. And hell is perhaps like the most miserable moment that you can possibly experience on earth forever and ever. And we come to our main verse, Romans 3:23, and we ask that question, seriously, everyone? Because in our culture and day and age, it's not a popular belief, right? We don't want to believe that people will be sent to hell if they reject God. If you post that on your Instagram or your Facebook or your TikToks, you're not going to... My youth students are like rolling their eyes at me because I'm embarrassing them like a good dad would, his kids. But you're not going to get the likes. You're not going to get the cute emojis and the thumbs up for posting that because it's not a very warm, heart-friendly message to share. And yet, what do we do with it? What do we do with it? And what does the Bible really say? And some of you, if you've grown up at the church, maybe you memorize this verse. I remember memorizing this verse in Awana when I was a young kid, right? Like, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It's one of the basic truths that we have to understand, is that we all are messed up. And most of us, we know that at a gut level. None of us are perfect. And James 2 even says, he says, if someone kept the whole law, right, lived perfectly, and yet stumbled in one point, they're guilty of all of it. Because it's not about the size of the infraction, whether it's a minor sin or a major sin. The fact is sin in the sight of a holy and righteous and perfect and pure God. And any minor infraction is a major deal to God, because he's perfect and he's pure. And unrighteous and sinful people cannot live in fellowship for eternity with him. Only that which is perfect deserves to be in the presence of God. I want to ask you to turn to Romans 3, verse 9, and we're going to read quite a few verses and see some of the context in which Paul writes this. So go ahead and turn there on your phone so you can see. I'm not going to have it on the screen here. Or if you have brought a Bible with you, you can turn to Romans 3. And Paul is writing the book of Romans to the church in Rome, where there's a mixed group of both Jews and non-Jews. The Jews would have been the one who grew up at least with a frame of reference of this God, of God the Father, and grew up knowing the law and the prophets and knowing about the character of God and who he is and knowing the story and their history and past. And so Paul's writing, and he opens the book saying, yes, I'm, you know, Paul, and I'm not ashamed of the gospel. I've been called to preach the gospel. But he also talks about how, and traces back to humanity's history and how it's gone completely wrong, and how people decided to trade their worship of their creator to worship created things, and how God let them do it, and how the experience was not good. And so Paul's talking about these things, and he gets to Romans 3, and he says this in verse 9, what shall we conclude then? Do we have any advantage? Not at all. For we have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throats are open graves. Their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways. In the way of peace, they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by the works of the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of sin. All. No, not one. Paul strings together these Old Testament quotes, some from Isaiah, some from the Psalms, to basically show that the truth is, no matter where you come from, no matter what ethnicity you are, whether you're rich, poor, tall, short, red, yellow, black, and white, all are filthy sinners. As my seminary professor used to remind us, we are all foolish-minded, dark-hearted enemies of God, and that's how we were born. Now, at this point, some of you are like, man, I wish I would have just stayed home this morning, because, like, didn't we let this guy go, like, a couple weeks ago? Like, why has he got to come back here and talk about how all of us should be destined for hell? But it's the truth of God's word. And ever since the garden, that has been the case. And as I was meditating on this verse the past 2 weeks, I thought, this idea of falling short of the glory of God, we kind of get that, but what does that mean to fall short of God's glory? And when I think of the glory of God, it reminds me of the Old Testament picture of the tabernacle, when the Israelites had built this tabernacle, this temporary dwelling in the wilderness to worship God, because they had been in Egypt for 400 years, and now Moses leads them out to worship the one true God, and God gives them these instructions. And what happens at the end when they followed it all? It says that the glory of God descended upon the temple and filled the Holy of Holies, and the people were afraid. They were terrified. It's like, you know, we're not worthy, right? And they're like telling Moses, you know, you be the mediator between us and God, because we can't even bear to gaze upon the glory of God. They had this sense of falling short. But if you go even further back, right, back to the garden, and the garden story starts, where God creates this good world, and he creates it with work and play and endless possibilities, and he tells them, be fruitful and multiply. And he does all that before Adam and Eve sinned. So we know that even before sin entered into the world, there was meaningful work. There was, God created the world for life and for good things. And he called it good. But God is love. And the way that he creates love is that he doesn't force it on people. Human beings have a supreme potential in the fact that they can reflect the glory of God. I believe that's what it means to be created in God's image. To be created in God's image is to reflect God's glory to the world around you. So Adam and Eve, and I believe they did this for a time. They lived in perfect fellowship with God. They reflected God's glory. They did not fall short until the tree, right? And God gives them this rule, but it's not an arbitrary rule. The rule represents the opportunity to say, God, I'm going to let you be you, and I'm going to follow you and walk in your ways. Or the opportunity to assume his place and to decide good and evil on my own terms. And that's what they did. They chose poorly. They chose to place themselves in place of God and decide what is good and evil, what is right and wrong on their own terms, as opposed to looking to the God who created them. And right there and then, they fell short of his glory. And hell is the inevitable consequence of it. It started in the garden. And we're all born into that. And so what do we do with that? And there's much we could study on this topic. And again, even Francis Chan, that book, and I would recommend the book to check it out. It's not a long read, but even he says, as he starts the book, he said, if you're excited to read this book about hell, there's something wrong with you, right? There's something kind of twisted, because it's a sobering thought. It's a sobering reality. And he actually says this. He was writing one of the chapters in Starbucks. He's talking about how, you know, people are ordering their mocha frappuccino, skinny vanilla latte, dragon fruit milk things. And he's like, the place is buzzing with vitality and it's great. And he's like, it's awesome. It's the part of life that you love. People are having conversations, you know, meeting up for coffee. And he says this. He says, there are at least a dozen people within 10 feet of me right here, right now, that may end up in the agony that I'm studying. What do I do? Do I keep writing? Do I keep studying? Should I bag this whole book thing and start building relationships with these people? How can I believe these passages and yet sit here silently? It says, coming face to face with these passages on hell and asking these tough questions is a heart-wrenching process. It forces me back to a sobering reality. This is not just about doctrine, it's about destinies. And if you're reading this book and wrestling with what the Bible says about hell, you cannot let this be a mere academic exercise. You must let Jesus' very real teaching on hell sober you up. You must let Jesus' words reconfigure the way you live, the way you talk, and the way you see the world and the people around you. Does it change how you see the people around you? Which sometimes begs the question of people like, well, what kind of God would send people to hell? That's a good question. As Pastor Eric and I were discussing this week's message and we're talking about that question, felt as if it's the wrong way to frame it. Because God doesn't send people to hell. He unnecessarily saves people from hell. The real question should be, well, why would God even give humanity a chance? Why would he do it? And the fact is that, as C.S. Lewis says, that for those who reject God and decide not to embrace him and not come to him through Jesus, God says, thy will be done. You want an eternity without me? You want to be disconnected from your creator? Thy will be done. And hell is the consequent and judgment in response to that. But the rest of the truth is this, that for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. And to those who receive Christ by faith, he gives the right and privilege to become the children of God. To those who believe in his name, he gives the right to become children of God. John 1:12 says that. Also says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ will be saved. And if there is no hell, what is there to be saved from? I get that there's hell on earth that we want to be saved from and to see alleviated. But to be saved is to be saved for living here and now, but also saved for an eternity that we get to spend with God through faith in Christ. So as we think about these things and as you meditate on this, and again, I think every sermon is a starting point, right? It's not supposed to begin and end here. This is life. This is what we are meant to live and dwell on and think about. But how should we live and how should we respond? And I have three things that I want to leave you with today. The first one is this: Christian, remember often what you were saved from. I have to admit, when I had received the message that from Errol that this was a topic that was going to be preached on this week, I was thinking about it and I thought, you know what? I can't remember the last time. Because again, look, I got saved when I was 5 and I grew up in the church and we talked about hell and this, but I'm like, I can't remember the last time that I really like thought about what I was saved from. And I just paused and thought about that for a moment. And really, it's humbling. It's so humbling, and it wells you up with gratitude when you look and see that you deserve the worst, and yet God in his mercy and grace has offered you Christ. There's a podcast that I listen to occasionally by a guy named Jocko Willink, who's a former Navy SEAL. And I remember listening to him one time, and he was talking about, he was a SEAL commander in Iraq back in the mid-2000s. And he talks about one of his soldiers, a guy named Mark, who actually was a believer. He's told this story a bunch of times. But he's talking about this guy, Mark, and Mark died in the line of duty. He was in a battle in Ramadi in Iraq, and he died, and was one of the several soldiers that Jocko lost under his command. And he carries that with him. And he talks about how even years, these many, many years later, he never forgets the sacrifice of his friends. Because these guys train together tight, right? You form a tight bond. You're training day in, day out, because you know that you may be called on a mission, and they were. And they go in willingly to pay the ultimate sacrifice for our country. He says, I wake up every day not taking for granted the freedom that I have and what I get to do and how I get to live. He says, I remember Mark, because Mark laid down his life for me and for our country, and I'm not going to waste my life. I'm going to live up to the best that I can because I have the opportunity. Christian, we have a Savior who willingly came and laid down his life for us. how much more should we wake up every day and say, I'm not going to waste it. I'm going to spend my life following Jesus, invested in his kingdom and his priorities, which leads to the next point, alleviate suffering by participating in heaven. We talk about hell on earth and how there are many situations where hell is, we can name, 100 different things if we sat here and wrote all of them down, but there's lots of things on earth that are terrible, that are wrongs, that are injustices, that are bad, that we can do something about. And it may be in our home, right? To alleviate the hell in our home, or to alleviate the hell in our community, or alleviate the hell across the world. And I love that there are Christian organizations that you can partner with for the sake of the gospel. I mean, I love what Julie is involved in, right? In Haiti. We are on a mission as a church supporting that ministry, and many of you have gone there and been down there. And just sitting with kids who are in one of the poorest nations on earth, helping to alleviate the hell that they might have experienced when they were abandoned. And yet they were rescued through the ministry that we support. And they get food and nourishment and education and care. We're called to that. We're called to that. Because Jesus, one of his primary messages was that the kingdom of God is here and it's coming in and through me. And that kingdom, that heaven gets expressed in many different ways, and we can be a part of that. And he's called us to do that. And as we do that, invite others to experience the rescue of Jesus. Invite others to experience the rescue of Jesus. Because we're not called just to action, we're called to words as well. And to share. And I don't think it necessarily looks like standing on a street corner, right, preaching hell and fire and brimstone and yelling at people, right? Peter said, always be ready to give an answer for the hope that you have, but to do so with gentleness and respect. And as I thought about that and thought about, we should have that urgency. We should be sitting in Starbucks or wherever we get our coffee, the Dunkin' Donuts, or a crowded gymnasium as we're watching our kids' sports, and have those sobering moments like, my goodness, how many people in here have hell as their destiny? What do I need to do about that? That's challenging. And we need to invite others to experience the rescue of Jesus. And to live with urgency. And I was reminded of a quote by a basketball coach. It was a weird connection my brain makes sometimes. But he always used to tell his players, be quick, but don't hurry. Be quick, but don't hurry. Be in the right position, be quick, be ready to move, ready for action. But if you try to hurry in an anxious way and kind of rush it, you'll often stumble and make a mistake, right? So it's this balance of an urgency to live, to preach the gospel, to talk to people, but understanding and having the humility to say that the Holy Spirit, of course, has the primary role. And the Holy Spirit will work in people, and sometimes his timetable is not our timetable, but recognize that we're partnering with the Holy Spirit to bring others to Jesus. And sometimes it's going to look like harvesting, and sometimes like planting seeds. The truth is this, in light of all that we've talked about regarding hell today, the church of Jesus is still the hope in light of hell, in light of all of these truths, in light of this doctrine. The church of Jesus is the hope. He's entrusted us with the message. He's entrusted us and called us to bear witness to his goodness and his grace and his rescue. And if you're sitting here today and you've never made that decision, I would encourage you, think about that. It's as simple as expressing your faith to God, sometimes through, it could be a prayer, to simply say, hey, God, I recognize that I am a sinner and deserve hell, but I put my faith in Jesus, my only rescue. He's my rock. He's my solid ground. my hope is in him. And scriptures say that if you do that, you will be saved. You will become a part of the family of God and to spend eternity in fellowship with him. And not only eternity then, but to join the movement of Jesus followers of every nation, tribe, and tongue that is reflecting the kingdom today. So let us be a church. And I believe this with all my heart. After working here for 17 years, I love our church. I love the ways over the years that I've observed us step up to the call to invite people in to experience the rescue of Jesus. And we need that. Whether you've been here for 5 months or 5 years or 15 years, we need you who are younger, who are kids, who are teenagers to carry on that legacy, to pass it on. We're always only one generation away, right? So let us be a church that has a heart for those who don't know Jesus. Let us be a church that prays for God to bring more opportunities to shine the light of Christ into a dark and hellish world. Let us pray for God to give us the courage not to be ashamed of the gospel. And let us pray that God would use ordinary people like us to accomplish great things for his kingdom. Amen? Heavenly Father, we're humbled by this truth. It's uncomfortable. It's scary. And yet, God, you've given us your word and you've given us Jesus. And so thank you, Jesus, for the rescue that we have in you. As we step into this week, Jesus, let us be reminded of all that you have done for us. And thank you for Holy Spirit for dwelling in us. Let us be sensitive to listen to your promptings in our hearts, even this week, as we bear witness to your truth. We love you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Walk with God this week, church. We'll see you next week. Thanks for joining us this morning.